إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the du'as that are mentioned in the Quran upon the tongues of the prophets are the greatest of du'as. And in today's first half of our khutbah, I will mention two du'as that I believe every single one of us should not just memorize but use frequently. All of us know these du'as. There are Qur'anic du'as on the tongues of the prophets of Allah. And so today we will inshaAllah ta'ala remind ourselves of the meanings and the power of two phrases from the tongues of two prophets. The first of them is the dua of the Prophet Ibrahim, and the second is the dua of the Prophet Yunus alayhi salam. And both of these duas were said at times of great difficulty, at times of distress, when it appeared that there was no hope left. What dua did the Prophet say when all hope of this world was cut off? We learn in the Qur'an and in the Sunnah the du'as of these two prophets. As for the du'a of the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, it is mentioned in the Qur'an upon the tongue of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But we know from the hadith that the Prophet Ibrahim used it before our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Qur'an mentions that when the Sahaba were gathered, were surrounded by the Ahzab, by the 10,000 strong around Medina, and they really could not fight 10,000 strong. What did they say? Allah says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمُ النَّاسُ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدَ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ The people, meaning the righteous people, are those who, when mankind gathered to attack them, and mankind told them, or other people told them, aren't you terrified? Aren't you scared? What was the phrase that came to the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba? حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ This was the dua. حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ And Ibn Abbas narrated that when the Prophet Ibrahim was about to be thrown into that fire. What fire is this? This is the fire of Nimrud. This is the fire that for 3 days and three nights, it was made hotter and hotter. The fire that they wanted to punish Ibrahim with when they accused him of destroying their idols. And instead of responding back, he mocked them and said, no, must be the other idols who killed the biggest one. They must have been jealous of him. So this young boy Ibrahim, probably 14, 15 years old, this young boy Ibrahim alayhi salam, and we learn from the tradition, he was the only Muslim on earth at the time. There was no other Muslim other than him at that time. And he believes in Allah and he rejects the idols. So when these evil people, when these mighty kings surround him and they tell him, unless you apologize and come back to our way, we will kill you in this manner. And they torture him for 3 days. And then they make this fire. And before they throw him in, what does he say? Ibn Abbas said, when Ibrahim was about to be thrown into the fire, he said, حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ This is the dua of Ibrahim. And Ibn Abbas said, and this was also the dua of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ when he was surrounded by the Ahzab. When all of the armies had gathered, this was the dua that came to the tongue of our Prophet ﷺ. So what is this dua? And what does it mean? Why is this dua so powerful? Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil, the singular. Hasbuna is the plural. We should all know hasbi, if we are alone and we say it, is hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil. And if we're saying it with a group or a gathering, hasbuna, rather than hasbi, it'll become hasbuna Allah wa ni'mal wakil. And you may add, if you want, ni'mal mawla wa ni'mal nasir, but the minimum is hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil. What does this mean? And why is this dua so powerful? And why was it so effective in the lives of these prophets? The phrase hasbi Allah means Allah is sufficient for me. I don't need anybody else. Hasbi Allah. I only need Allah. I don't need anyone else. Wa ni'mal wakil. And what a perfect wakil here means not just protector, but someone whom I delegate my affairs to. Someone who will take charge of what I need to be done. Hasbi Allah. I only need Allah. Wa ni'mal wakil. And what a beautiful protector and wakil he is. What does this dua mean? Why is it so powerful? When you say hasbi Allah, you can only say hasbi Allah when you know who is Allah. And then you put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A heart that doesn't have iman, a heart that is ignorant of Allah, cannot say hasbi Allah. When you say hasbi Allah, you are affirming the power of Allah, the love of Allah, the fact that Allah knows who you are, what you're doing, how much you need Him. When you say hasbi Allah, you are saying, oh Allah, I recognize that when you decide to do something, nobody can come between you and your will. There is no strength, there is no power other than you. When you say hasbi Allah, you say, I don't care who is against me. If Allah is on my side, that's all that I need. So hasbi Allah is something that is coming from the heart. And it is affirming the power and the protection and the might of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you say hasbi Allah, you automatically imply, who needs anybody other than Allah? He who has Allah doesn't need anybody else. And he who has everything except for Allah has nothing. He who has Allah does not need anyone else. And he who has everything other than Allah, in reality he has nothing. So when you say hasbi Allah, you are affirming the perfection of Allah, the love of Allah, the rahmah of Allah, the concern of Allah. You are saying that if Allah Azza wa Jal helps me, then no one else can ever get in between him and his help. And when you say hasbi Allah, you are also affirming your own iman in Allah. Not only that Allah Azza wa Jal is perfect, but you recognize that. Imagine the heart of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Imagine, surrounded by a city, an army. The mightiest king alive is in front of him, threatening him, torturing him. He's a 15-year-old kid. There's that fire that's been put for 3 days and three nights. Not a single human being in the world, his own father, is on the side of the prosecution. Just imagine. Not a single soul in the world to help him. Yet what does he know? Allah will protect me. Hasbi Allah. Oh Allah, you are in charge of taking care of these mighty armies. Oh Allah, I turn to you. You will deal with this fire. You will take charge of this whole world that has gathered against me. Hasbi Allah. I only need Allah. I don't need anybody else. So what happens? When Ibrahim is thrown into that fire, the fire itself becomes a garden for him. A garden, a pleasant walk in the park. It becomes beautiful, fragrant, green, cool. This is what happens when you put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you say hasbi Allah, you affirm the power of Allah and you affirm, oh Allah, I believe in your power. I believe in your might. I believe that you are the one who is Rahman and Rahim and Sami' and Alim and Quddus and Malik. Oh Allah, you are the real Malik. So when you say hasbi Allah, you can only say it when it's coming from the depths of your heart. When you understand who is Allah and you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah tells us in the Quran, وَمَن يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. Whoever truly trusts in Allah, Allah will take care of him. Allah Azza wa Jal is enough for him. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَن يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Whoever truly trusts in Allah, Allah Azza wa Jal will make an escape route for him, will make a passage of exit for him, and Allah will provide for him in a manner that he did not expect. Allah will take care of him in a manner that he did not expect. Meaning, if you truly put your trust in Allah, Allah Azza wa Jal will take care of your calamity, will deal with your distress, will take charge of defeating your enemies in ways you don't expect. And so Ibrahim alayhi salam, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Sahaba, this is the dua that we say when we are faced with major calamity, major stress, when we have major, here we have the enemies of Islam physically attacking. There is no protection other than Allah's protection. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hasbi Allah. وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ means, and what a beautiful, what a perfect, what a majestic wakil. What is a wakil? A wakil is somebody, in Arabic you call sometimes a lawyer is a wakil. Right? Even in Urdu we call the wakil is a lawyer. Why? Because when you hire a wakil, when you have a wakil, what do? You sit down and you let the wakil do the business for you. You hire the best wakil, you hire the best lawyer, this is in our terms the lawyer, and if you really hire a good lawyer, you literally sit down and he'll do the job for you. He'll defend you. He'll make sure that the judge treats you in the manner you deserve. That's what the wakil we call. But Allah Azza wa Jal isn't just a wakil. He is al-wakil. Al-wakil means you trust him for everything. You delegate everything to him. That Allah will take care of this. He is the al-wakil. وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ. And what a beautiful, what a majestic, what a powerful wakil he is. Ni'ma here is a praise of Allah and it's also an affirmation. Oh Allah, you are the best wakil. There is no wakil like you. And so when you say, حَسْبِي اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ, so Allah Azza wa Jal will become sufficient for you. And Allah Azza wa Jal will do what needs to be done. This is what wakil. You are basically saying, oh Allah, I can't do it. I can't do it, O Allah. I need you. حَسْبِي اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ. I put you in charge, O Allah, and you are enough for the job. You are enough to take care of me because you are my Rabb. You are the Rahman and the Rahim. You are the Malik. So, O Allah, you are the one to deal with this affair. And this is exactly what happened in the lives of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and also in the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We've all done this story in detail in our seerah lessons. When the battle of Ahzab took place, and 10,000 strong were surrounding Medina, and there were barely 1,500 sahaba. There's no way they could physically fight against 10,000. 10,000 armed men, and they cut off the supplies. For 1 month, they cut off the supplies. How long can you last? The people were beginning to eat vegetables, the leaves of the trees. They had nothing to eat. They're starving. They haven't had a proper meal for weeks. How long can the siege last? What is going to happen? They cannot fight. The Quraysh are outside with all of their allies, 10,000 strong. They cut off all of the food supplies, all of the caravans. How long can this go on? So they say, Hasbunallahu wa ni'mal wakil. And what happens? What happens? An army from the heavens comes. And 10,000 strong are rerouted, fled helter-skelter overnight. Because Allah Azza wa Jal sent, as He said, وَجُنُودًا لَمْ تَرَوْهَا. He sent an army, you did not see it. The wind began to blow, the thunderstorm, a tornado in the middle of the desert, and the sand was so severe and hard that they all had to flee 10,000 strong. Can you imagine? An army of 10,000 was destroyed without one sword being unsheathed. Think about that. Without one sword being unsheathed. 10,000 strong simply disappeared overnight. Why? Because hasbunallahu wa ni'mal wakil, that is the power of when you trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He'll take care of an entire army and you don't even have to unsheathe your sword. But as long as you show that tawakkul, as long as you recognize, oh Allah, you will deal with it, you will take care of it. حَسْبِي اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. And of course, I have to add here as well, that you only do this after you have done everything in your power. The Sahaba built the trench. The Sahaba armed themselves. The Sahaba were ready for battle if need be. They didn't just sit in their houses and say, Allah will take care. You do everything you can physically, and then you say, the rest is up to you, oh Allah. And really, oh Allah, I only need you. حَسْبِي اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. And also we have a beautiful incident of Aisha radiallahu anha as well. In the story of the slander, the famous story of the slander that took place, that when she heard that this slander was happening, what was the one word that comes to her mouth? The one phrase that comes to her mouth? حَسْبِي اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. Imagine Aisha, the young wife, she's a young lady at the time. She knows enough that the one phrase that comes to her mind, they have spoken about me in this manner. What was the one phrase that immediately came to her mind? Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakeel. Allah will take care of me. And what a beautiful protector He is. And what happened? What happened? To protect Aisha, Allah revealed over 20 verses of the Holy Quran that we recite to this day. And Aisha said, I never thought that I was that significant that Allah would reveal Quran about me. This is what Aisha said. Who am I? She was thinking. Of course she is Ummahat al-Mu'minin. Of course she is worthy. But she is in her modesty and humility saying, who am I that Allah will reveal Quran about me to be recited to the Day of Judgment? But this is what happens when you put your trust in Allah. Hasbi Allahu wa ni'mal wakeel. When it comes from your heart, when you assign Allah Azza wa Jal to take care of your deeds, then this is what is going to happen. Allah will even reveal Quran for you, as He did for Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So this is the first dua. Let us memorize it. Let us use it. And the second dua, which is also used at times of distress, at times of difficulty. I wanted both these duas to be, because we go through all types of difficulties. Every one of us, life is nothing but difficulty, and one tragedy after another. This is the reality of life. So the second dua as well is a beautiful dua, and it is the dua of the Prophet Yunus alayhi salam. As we all know, the Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, he left his city without getting permission from Allah to leave. And this was a sin for the Prophets. The Prophets cannot leave the city until Allah tells them. The Prophet Yunus gave up. He said, my people are bad, they're not accepting, khalas, let me just go. And it wasn't appropriate for the Prophet to do this. And so what happened, as we know, that he went onto the ship, and the people of the ship, they said, somebody has bad luck here, or somebody is bringing this punishment. Who must it be? They drew lots, and it came to Yunus, and there was a thunderstorm going. It was the middle of the night. They said, you're the one causing this omen. And of course, we don't believe in omens. These were not Muslims that were doing this. Nonetheless, they said, you're the cause of this bad luck. We need to get rid of you. And so, in the middle of a dark and stormy night, in the middle of the ocean, when the thunder is going and the rain is pouring, complete darkness, they pick Yunus alayhi salam and they fling him over the ocean. Just think about that. If any of you have ever been in the middle of the seas, how terrifying it is even on a beautiful day if you fall into that ocean. Imagine in the middle of the night when the waves are coming and the thunder and the rain, and they throw him into the middle of that darkness, and he plunges and plunges and plunges, and as you all know, then Allah Azza wa Jal causes a fish, a whale, to swallow him. And that's why the Quran calls him Dhun-Noon, Dhan-Noon. A noon in the Quran here means whale, the one of the whale. So Yunus is called the companion of the whale. And the whale takes him deep, deep, deep down the depths of the sea. Imagine, brothers and sisters, wallahi, these are stories that we know happen. It's in the Quran. We believe in them. Imagine being the Prophet Yunus. Imagine that claustrophobia, that stench, not able to breathe, completely blind in the depths of the ocean. And Allah Azza wa Jal says, what did he do? He realized he made a mistake. He realized he made a mistake. So what? Allah says, وَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ. He called out in the depths of the darkness. Wallahi, how much darkness was there? The darkness of the night. The darkness of the depths of the ocean. The darkness of the inner chambers of the whale. Darkness over darkness over darkness. Complete and pitch darkness. Can you imagine the terror, the fear that any one of us might have had? We would have died simply of a heart attack. We would have died of fear. But Yunus alayhi salam, he realized, I need Allah Azza wa Jal. And so what did he do? وَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَلَّا إِلَٰهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. From the depths of the ocean, he calls out, لَا إِلَٰهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ. Oh Allah, there is nobody worthy of being praised, worthy of being worshipped, worthy of being glorified other than you. سُبْحَانَكَ. Exalted are you above anything. Meaning what? Some people who don't have strong faith, they blame Allah for their calamities and tragedies. They say, this is because of Allah. This is because of God. Why is God punishing us? Why is God doing this to me? And this is a common phrase we hear. I'm a good person. Why is God doing this to me? La hawla wa quwwata illa billah. We do not speak like this. We do not accuse Allah of any injustice or evil. So subhanaka here means, exalted are you, O Allah. You are only worthy of praise. You are not worthy of any criticism. Subhanak, exalted are you. Subhanaka means we negate anything negative. It's a double negative. We negate anything negative. Alhamdulillah, we praise for a positive. Alhamdulillah is Allah's perfection. Subhanallah is the negation of Allah's imperfection. Alhamdulillah is Allah's perfection. Allah is worthy of being praised because of His names and attributes, because of who He is. Subhanallah, Allah Azza wa Jal is we negate any negative. So for example, when Allah says, Allah has not taken a son, subhanahu, He should be negated from having a son. Subhanahu, He's too exalted to have a son. Too holy to have a son. Allah says, they took false gods besides Him, subhanahu. All glory be to Him. He doesn't deserve false gods being ascribed to Him. So, subhanaka here implies, O Allah, You are not worthy of any criticism. You're only worthy of worship. Inni kuntu min al-zalimin. I was the one who made a mistake. I was the one who fell into a sin. I was the one who transgressed. Inni kuntu min al-zalimin. And therefore, dear brothers and sisters, when a person says this phrase, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin, he affirms for himself that I have fallen short. It was my mistake and error. And if this is the Prophet Yunus saying he made a mistake, then where do we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If a Prophet of Allah is saying, I made a mistake, it was my mistake, what is the mistake here? Of course, all of us make mistakes. We fall into sins. We fall into things that are haram. We don't do the wajibat. We don't thank Allah as much as we should thank Him. All of this is a type of dhulm. And so, he affirmed Allah's perfection. He sought Allah's forgiveness. And he acknowledged his own mistakes. So he combined between tawheed, la ilaha illallah, and negating anything negative, subhanak, and then affirming or describing imperfection to himself. And this is the perfection of repentance. You say, Allah, You are perfect, I am imperfect. You are holy, I am sinful. You are the ilah and the God, and I am the marbub and the abd. I am the one who is under Your control. So when you affirm Allah's perfection and your own imperfection, you are being humble. And humility is the essence of worship. Humility is the essence of worship. Like we bow our heads down in sajda, why? We take our most noble organ, our most respected part of the body, and that is the head, and we lower it into the dirt. Oh Allah, You are worthy of this humility. You are worthy of this subservience. You are worthy of this ibadah. And that will raise our ranks in this world and the next. So when we say, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin, we are affirming Allah is perfect. And we are acknowledging, I am imperfect. And when we do this, Allah shows His perfection to us. The opposite of this is Iblis. The opposite of this is Iblis, who is too arrogant to recognize. And he says, I am better. I am the one who deserves this. This is Iblis. When Adam was, he was told to prostrate to Adam, what did he say? I am the one. So the opposite of this is arrogance. And when you're arrogant, you will not get anything. When you're humble in front of Allah, this is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless you. And therefore, what happened with Yunus alayhi salam? From the depths of the darkness, the whale comes all the way to the top. At the crack of dawn, at the break of dawn, the sun is shining now. And the whale goes all the way to the shore and spits him out onto the shore. And so Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, فَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمِّ. We were the ones who saved him from his distress. And then, listen to this phrase and memorize it, brothers and sisters. It is one of the most optimistic phrases in the Quran. وَكَذَٰلِكَ نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And in this manner, when the mu'min says, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin, in this manner, we shall save all of those who are in distress. All of those who believe, all of those who turn to me, we will save all of them. So this dua is said whenever you are distressed. Yunus was distressed because of the problems of the whale, the problems of the... We are distressed because of other problems, much less trivial than Yunus, but nonetheless they are big for us. Family problems, financial problems, our boss is giving us an attitude, we're worried about our job, our family issues. These are our dhulumat. These are our darknesses. So when we are surrounded by these darknesses, what do we say? La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. This should be our dua all the time. And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, in a hadith in Musnad Imam Ahmad, that the dua of Dhunnun, meaning the dua of the one of the whale, that he cried out with when he was in the stomach of the whale, was La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. And then our Prophet ﷺ said, no Muslim ever says this dua except that Allah will answer him. No Muslim ever says this dua except that Allah will answer him. So these are the two du'as, brothers and sisters. Memorize them. Make them a daily part of your rituals. Hasbi Allahu wa ni'mal wakil. And La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. Barakallahu wa lakum fi Qur'an al-azim. Wa nafa'ani wa yakum bima fihi min al-ayati wa dhikr al-hakim. Aqulu ma tasma'un wa astaghfirullah al-azim li wa lakum wa lisa'il muslimin kulli dhanbin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwa al-ghafurur rahim.